when you have no one to show you what to do? How do you find your way when your country doesn't have a place for you? How do you have your say? How do you make them pay? Those wealthy New England Congress fucks would rather tax us and play polo all day than defend the frontier. No one is doing anything about it. Everyone around here is all pissed off, but no one's taking a stand. So I guess then that it's up to me. 1, 2, 3, 4! There's nothing left in this old town. Pick up your life and move it around. And what is here for me in Tennessee? Pick up your rifle and make a stand. You always said I should be like that guy. But guess what? I'm telling you, I'm not that guy. I'm not that guy. Who am I? Andrew fucking Jackson. And my life sucks in particular. Life sucks. And my life sucks in particular.
Populism, yeah, yeah. Populism, yeah, yeah. Populism. In the last episode of History Sci-Fi Theater, the North had come to love tariffs because they made people buy more American manufactured goods, while the South hated tariffs because they hurt trade with Europe. And now, this week's episode. In the dark recesses of his underground laboratory, Dr. Regional Division transmogrifies North-South tensions into the Tariff of Abominations.
It's alive!
Southerners fear the tariff.
Run for your lives!
It'll ruin our economy.
While Northerners don't mind it at all.
It's kind of cute, really.
What a sweetie.
Andrew Jackson's vice president, John C. Calhoun of South Carolina, says the South has the right to secede or withdraw from the Union.
Either that thing goes or we go.
But President Jackson isn't having it.
You'll stay in the Union, whether you like it or not.
We'll not.
We'll too.
Then lock up that monster.
By 1832, there were newer, even bigger tariffs, and the country was on the brink of civil war. When Jackson and Calhoun brought in respected statesman Henry Clay, who had previously developed the Missouri Compromise of 1820, to tame the beast.
I'll save the day. Unity is more important than tariffs.
And so a compromise was reached. Northerners accepted lower tariffs, and Southerners remained in the Union. Henry Clay had once again defeated the evil Dr. Regional Division. Or had he?
But there is more than forest to clear.
It's always been one of the deep flaws of the American imagination that it can't imagine a future for American Indian people. As Americans, American Indian people have to imagine that for themselves. And that's the hard part.
Keep walking.
1830, Frontier President Andrew Jackson declares a new policy, a policy that America will maintain for more than 100 years. The forced relocation of American tribal people onto reservations.
You keep moving.
After years of Supreme Court battles, the bill passes Congress by a single vote. Chickasaw, Choctaw, Creek, Seminole, Cherokee, all forced off their nations by the point of a bayonet. An episode in the conquest of the West that even some of the soldiers taking part find shameful. U.S. Army Private John G. Burnett writes,
"The sufferings of the Cherokee were awful. The trail of the exiles was a trail of death. They slept in the wagons and on the ground without fire. I saw as many as 20 die in a single night of pneumonia, cold, exposure."
Move along. Move along.
The march of 1,000 miles becomes a trail of tears.
It's a shameful act in American history, and it's in its own way sort of an iconic act because it really symbolizes what happened to the Native Americans.
Beach.
we made by hand. On our days made in Japan. Cherokee people, Cherokee tribe, so proud to live, so proud to die. They took the whole Indian nation, locked us on this reservation. I wear a shirt and tie, I'm still part red man deep inside. Cherokee people, Cherokee tribe, so proud to live, so proud. Someday when they've learned, Cherokee Nation will return, will return, will return, will return.
In 1859, as America was rushing towards civil war, James Parton, the first historian to attempt a biography of Andrew Jackson, arrived at the Hermitage, Jackson's beloved home. He was escorted through the mansion by Hannah Jackson, who had been Andrew Jackson's slave from the time she was 10 until Jackson died. Parton knew that many Americans considered Andrew Jackson the country's greatest leader since the Founding Fathers. Parton wrote,
"During the last 30 years of his life, he was the idol of the American people. Columbus had sailed, Washington fought, Jefferson written. 50 years of democratic government had passed, and the result of it all was that the people of the United States honored Andrew Jackson before all other living men."
Andrew Jackson, in my mind, is one of the great presidents. And it's not surprising that he was so loved. In fact, It is said that when the Civil War broke out in 1861, people wanted to vote for Andrew Jackson, hoping he would come back and save the Union. He was that beloved.
For all of his flaws, for all of his contradictions, Andrew Jackson did more than any other American of his generation to enlarge the possibilities of American democracy. In doing that, in seeing himself as president, as the tribune of the people, he did more than anyone to change to enlarge the possibilities of the American presidency.
But Jackson was also one of the most controversial presidents in American history. His policies on issues like Indian removal and slavery provoked fierce opposition, not only in his lifetime, but beyond.
Andrew Jackson, for African Americans, is not the sort of figure that one holds very dear. He wouldn't form part of the ranks of the great men of American society, because never in his reign as president, in his terms as president, did he ever attempt to expand the rights of people. On the contrary, he did everything he could, it seems to me, to constrict those rights, to limit those rights.
People talk about Andrew Jackson's black moods. People talk about Andrew Jackson's red-hot temper. But the color of this story is green, and it's the green of envy, and it's the green of coveting Indian lands.
At the Hermitage, Parton discovered a portrait of Jackson finished just before he died. It was completely unlike the many heroic portraits of the great man, and the vulnerability it captured brought to life Parton's most insightful description of Jackson.
He was a democratic autocrat, an urbane savage, an atrocious saint.
Americans have always looked at Andrew Jackson and seen themselves. But over the years, they've looked at Andrew Jackson and seen different versions of themselves. At one time, they saw the frontiersman, the poor boy made good, the classic self-made man. Today, some Americans look back at Jackson and they see the slaveholder, the Indian oppressor, even the Indian hater. So the debate about Andrew Jackson is a very contemporary one. He's an inescapable, quintessential American, but of what kind? Is he a man whom we should admire, or is he a man whom we should despise? Is he a man whom we should celebrate, or is he a man for whom we should apologize?